Praise the Lord. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Welcome to Never Shalom, Oasis of Peace. We are a spirit-filled,
Torah-observant, Messianic congregation
who worships our Creator through Messiah Yeshua. We use the name Yah or Yahweh when we refer to our Heavenly Father and Yeshua, the Messiah's Hebrew name, rather than Jesus, because we are the Hebraic part of the body of Messiah in the Rockford and State Line area. We believe that Yahweh has joined the whole house of Israel into one large body of believers. Because we are a Hebraic expression of that body, we worship Yah in a distinctly Hebraic way in our service. Our goal in every service is to encounter the living Elohim and to be transformed by him into his presence. Our service has an element of charismatic prayer and praise. We allow Yahweh's presence to move freely in our midst through song, Davidic dance, prophetic word, as well as all the other gifts of the Ruach Kodesh. The Torah service consists of some traditional synagogue liturgy, as well as readings from the prophets, the Renewed Covenant, and of course, Torah. Whenever Hebrew is used during the service, we try to have a verbal or printed translation as well. At this time, we're going to begin with an opening song that will allow each of us to stand and greet our neighbor and wish each other Shabbat Shalom. Since we know that not everyone who joins us keeps Erev Shabbat, we have chosen to open our service with the Kiddush. In this way, everyone who enters and worships with us has had a chance to consciously separate themselves from the busy work week and enter Yahweh's rest. Let's all rise for the Kiddush. Let us praise Yahweh with the symbol of joy and thank Him for the blessings of the past week, for life and strength, for home and love and friendship, for the discipline of our trials and temptations, for the happiness that has come to us out of our labors. Thou hast ennobled us, O Yah, by the blessings of work, and in love has sanctified us by Sabbath rest and worship as ordained in the Torah. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to be hallowed unto the Lord thy God. Praise be thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Baruch Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam. Being welcomed here today, allow your spirit to join with the Holy Spirit. Yeshua.
It is good to be in the house of Yahweh.
Amen.
And we bless you, Yah,
yes,
for who you are, for who you've created us to be, worshipers of the Most High. We thank you for all that you've done for us, all that you're doing for us, and all that you are about to do for us. We thank you that you are the author of life, and that's what you've given us. You have given us high hope, a good life, the Yeshua, in Yeshua. And so we praise you.
I'm
our Lord. You are Adonai.
Lord, over all.
is the greatest blessing. How we envy the angels that are always around your throne, in your presence. Basking in the light of your glory.
only will be filled with the knowledge of Yahweh as the waters cover the sea.
As we prepare to enter into the Torah service, we begin with chanting of the Shema. This comes from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. Those of you who know the Shema will notice that we add one all-important phrase, which reflects who we are as a congregation. Please stand with me now and face east towards Jerusalem as we say the Shema, first in Hebrew, then in English.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kevod Malchuso.
And scripture continues, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your life and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as reminders on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the doorframes of your houses and on your gates. Please remain standing and face front for the Torah service. If I can have my Torah servant come forth, please. The Torah was given by Yahweh to Moses. Since Yahweh commanded us not to have any graven images to him, the Torah is considered as close to Yahweh as we can get. Traditionally, the Torah is treated as if it were the presence of Yahweh himself. And it came to pass, whenever the ark went forward, Moshe would say, Kumai Yahweh! Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered. May those who hate you flee from before you. For from Zion shall go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord out of Jerusalem. Blessed be he who in his holiness gave the Torah to his people, Israel.
Moshe,
not as an idol, but as it is the written word of Yahweh. We know that it is a representation of the living word, Yeshua, dwelling among us. The Torah is the very first word we have from Yahweh. The prophets were measured against it, and so were the writings. Messiah Yeshua himself was measured very carefully against it. All of the Renewed Covenant writings were verified against it as well. Most important, it prefigured the Word made flesh, Messiah Yeshua. In addition to all the things just mentioned, it is the fervent desire of all believers that Yahweh's word would be constantly on our lips. As we pray the Torah, it has become a tradition to kiss the Torah as it passes by touching a tallit tzitzit, siddur, Bible, or one's hand to the cover, and then kissing that which was used to touch the cover. If you're not comfortable with this, you're not obligated. As I said, it is a tradition and not a law. Another tradition we have in our congregation is as Torah passes among us. We make special effort to face the Torah, following it with our eyes so as not to turn our backs towards it. In this way, we demonstrate to our Creator that we desire to have His Word in front of our eyes at all times, especially the living Word, Yeshua HaMashiach.
Baruch Atah Adonai.
who is blessed.
Bless the Lord, who is blessed forever and ever.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who chose us from all peoples and gave to us the Torah.
Blessed are you, Lord, giver of the Torah.
Amen.
This week's reading comes from the book of Bereshit, also known as Genesis. Let's turn to chapter 48. And from chapter 48, let's begin reading at verse 8 and go through 20.
Then Israel noticed Joseph's sons and asked, "Whose are these?" Joseph answered his father, "They are my sons, whom God has given me here." Yaakov replied, "I want you to bring them here to me so that I can bless them." Now Israel's eyes were dim with age, so they could not see. Joseph brought his sons near to him, and he kissed them and embraced them. Israel said to Joseph, "I never expected to see you again, but God has allowed me to see your children too." Then Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand, toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand, toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near to him. But Israel put out his right hand and laid it on the head of the younger one, Ephraim, and put his left hand on the head of Manasseh. He intentionally crossed his hands, even though Manasseh was the firstborn. Then he blessed Yosef, the God in whose presence my fathers Abraham and Isaac lived, the God who has been my own shepherd all my life long to this day, the angel who has rescued me from all harm. Bless these boys. May they remember who I am and what I stand for. And likewise my fathers, Abraham and Yitzhak, who they were and what they stood for. And may they grow into teeming multitudes on the earth." When Joseph saw that his father was laying his right hand on Ephraim's head, it displeased him. And he lifted up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head, and placed it instead on Manasseh's head. Joseph said to his father, "Don't do it that way, my father, for this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head." But his father refused and said, "I know that, my son. I know it. He too will become a people, and he too will be great. Nevertheless, his younger brother will be greater than he, and his descendants will grow into many nations." Then he added this blessing on them that day: "Israel will speak of you in their own blessings by saying, 'May God make you like Ephraim and Manasseh.'" Then he put Ephraim ahead of Manasseh. Israel then said to Joseph, "You see that I am dying, but God will be with you and will bring you back to the land of your ancestors. Moreover, I am giving you a shoulder ridge city of Shechem, more than to your brothers. I captured it from the Amorite with my sword and bow."
Now the blessing after the reading.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam Asher natan lanu Torah nevet V'keyeh olam natan v'dekeinu. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech haolam. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who gave to us the Torah of truth and life everlasting planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to invite Hadassah to make Aliyah for the Haftarah. He who blessed our fathers Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, may he bless Hadassah, who has come up to honor Yahweh and the writings of the prophets. May the Holy One bless her and her family and send blessing and prosperity on all the works of her hands.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, Melech Haolam, Asher Bachar, Nivkiim Tovim, Ratzav et Ibrahim, Hanamarim Ba'emet, Baruch Ata, Adonai, Haboker Batorah, Umoshe Ado, Ubi Israel Amo, Ubi Keha Emet, Batzedeh. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who selected good prophets, delighting the words which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chose the Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and the prophets of truth and righteousness.
This week's reading comes from the book of Malachim Aleph, which many of you know means First Kings. Let's turn to chapter 2. From chapter 2, we'll be reading the first four verses. Malachim Aleph, chapter 2. Verses 1 through 4.
The time came near for David to die, so he commissioned Shlomo, his son, as follows. I'm going the way of all the earth. Therefore, be strong. Show yourself a man. Observe the charge of Adonai your God to go in his ways and keep his regulations, mitzvot, rulings, and instructions in accordance with what is written in the Torah of Moshe, so that you will succeed in all you do, and wherever you go. If you do, Adonai will fulfill what he promised me when he said, if your children pay attention to how they live, conducting themselves before me honestly with all their heart and being, you will never lack a man on the throne of Israel.
And the blessing after the reading.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, rock of all ages, righteous throughout all generations. You are the faithful God, promising and then performing, for speaking, then fulfilling, for all your words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Lord our God, and faithful are your words, for no words of yours shall remain unfulfilled. You are a faithful and merciful God and King. Blessed are you, O Lord God, who are faithful in fulfilling your words.
Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite Nika to make Aliyah for the Brit Hadashah. You blessed our fathers, Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. May he bless Nika, who has come up to honor Yahweh and his renewed covenant. May the Holy One bless him and his family, and send blessing and prosperity on all the works of his hand.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the Mashiach Yeshua and the word of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the
covenant. This week's reading comes from the book of Yochanan, also known as John. Let's turn to chapter 13. From chapter 13, we'll be reading the first 19 verses.
It was just before the festival of Pesach, and Yeshua knew that the time had come for him to pass from this world to the Father. Having loved his own people in the world, he loved them to the end. They were at supper, and the adversary had already put the desire to betray him into the heart of Yehuda and Shimon from Trail. Yeshua was said to him, Lord, you're washing my feet? And Yeshua answered him, you don't understand yet what I am doing, but in time you will understand. No, Jesus said, you will never wash my feet. And Yeshua answered him, if I don't wash you, you have no share with me. Lord, Shimon Kiva said, not only my feet, but my hands and head too. Yeshua said to him, a man who has had a bath don't need to wash except his feet. His body is already clean. And you people are clean, but not all of you. He knew who was betraying, and this is why he said, not all of you are clean. After he had washed their feet, taken back his clothes, and returned to the table, he said to them, do you understand what I have done to you? You call me Rabbi and Lord, and you're right, because I am. Now, the Lord and Rabbi have washed your feet, you also should wash each other's feet. For I have set you an example, so that you may do as I have done to you. Yes, indeed, I tell you, a slave is not greater than his master, nor is an emissary greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you will be blessed if you can do it. I'm not talking to all of you. I know which ones I have chosen, but the words of the Tanakh must be fulfilled that say, one eating my bread has turned against me. And I'm telling you now, before it happens, so that when it does happen, you may believe that I am who I say I am.
This time I'd like to invite Hadassah to make Aliyah once again so that she can share the drash that the Lord has put on her heart regarding these scripture readings.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
It is good to be in the house of Yahweh. Amen. Okay, so this week is Parsha 12, and it is called Vayechi. It's a special one to me because this is my bat mitzvah, Parsha. And for those of you who don't know what bat mitzvah is or what bar mitzvah is, bar mitzvah means son of the commandment. And bat mitzvah means daughter of the commandment. And when you come of age to be responsible for keeping the commandments, you are confirmed in this way with a ceremony, and everybody gets a fountain pen. And, that's just traditional. You read the portion that is associated with the week of your birth. But I wasn't born this week in the Gregorian calendar, but today would be my Hebrew birthday. So a birthday so nice, you celebrate twice. So Vayechi means, and he lived. But as you can see, it's about the death of Yaakov.
According to the rabbis, Vayehi is a closed section. In the entire Torah scroll, Vayehi is unique in that there is no extra space between it and the preceding parashah. In contrast to the general rule that a sidra, which comes from the word sidur, or order, and is the weekly Torah portion, it begins on a new line, usually, or is separated by the previous one by at least a nine-letter space. There's all these rules of how you do the, you write a Torah. Everything's handwritten, and the reason you follow these rules, they didn't have computers back then where everything was consistent. As you know, from person to person, our handwriting is inconsistent. So some people have teeny tiny little signatures, and some have huge signatures. John Hancock, you know. And so as a different person, a sofer, that's what they're called, a sofer is one who copies exactly the Torah to make another Torah. And so the sofer, as not shofar, but sofer, is one who has to do it by hand, and they have to be consistent in the way they do it so that it doesn't surprise somebody who eventually will read it. You know, when you're reading your Bible, for instance, and you have a favorite Bible, and going through reading it over and over and over, you get to certain chapters and certain paragraphs, and you expect, okay, this chapter starts right at the top, or this chapter starts in the middle, or on the right side. You're used to it. You're used to reading your scriptures that way because it's consistent. Well, when you open a Torah scroll, the handwriting is not so consistent, but you still have to follow the rules. So the person, you know, goes to read the beginning of the chapter and goes, oh, where is it? You know. So it's consistent. So that's why they do that. That's why it's a practical thing. The Jewish people are very practical people. Okay, so the sage Rashi, he's a rabbi from years and years and years ago. He described Vayehi, this certain Torah portion, as stuma. Everyone say stuma.
Stuma.
Stuma. It means closed. So if you are a shop owner, or maybe you run a cafe or an art gallery, and somebody comes up to the door and wants to get in, but you're ready to lock up, you just turn the sign where this is closed and you go stuma. You know, and then behind the glass they think you're saying too bad. You know? So it just means closed. But what Rashi was saying, that this was closed because at the time of Yaakov's death, his children's hearts were closed. They weren't open anymore. They were closed in expectation of the suffering and despair of impending bondage. Something in their spirit or in their ruach, in their kishkis, and you know, something told them that bondage was coming. Alternatively, Yaakov wanted to reveal to his children the time of the end. He wanted to open that to his children. In other words, the messianic age when Israel's exile would finally end. But he was prevented from doing so because his prophetic vision was closed. It was concealed from him. So not only was his natural vision closed, his spiritual vision was also being closed. Now in Bereshit, in Genesis, Yaakov is about to die and Yosef brings his two little sons, maybe they're older sons, I don't know, I wasn't there. But he brings his sons to be blessed by Yaakov, by Israel. Now, you will note that Menashe is firstborn and Ephraim is secondborn. Now, at this point, and I, whenever I teach this, I always like to use volunteers from the audience. So could I have two volunteers, two sons, right there? Why don't you come up? you're going to stand right here. I need your other son. Yeah, okay. Now, I'm going to be you. Where's my guitar? Okay, so you're obviously the oldest, right? Okay, we can tell by the height differential. Okay, so it was supposed to be, why don't you switch places? Switch places, there you go. Okay, so the oldest is over here and the youngest over here. I'm sorry, you were right. Let's do that again, one more time, never mind. Okay, you were right. Okay, so this is the way that Yosef placed them before Yaakov. And so Yaakov was going to put his right hand on the older one and the left hand on the younger one to bless them. Because the older one, you get all the stuff. You get a smile. You get all the stuff. You get the car, you get the house, the land, all the toys, all the good stuff. Yeah, right? Insist on it. Okay, so he's going to get the biggest blessing. Now the younger one, don't be sad. You're going to get blessed too, but not as much as him. So shake your fist at him. Okay, so I'm Yaakov, and I'm supposed to do this, blessing older and younger, but I'll mess up your hair. But what does he do? He pulls the old switcheroo. He does that. And Yosef says, no, wait, and he replaces his hand. You know, now notice what happens, and I know these kids, this one is taller than me. When I do this, what am I doing?
I'm closing.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? When you close something, what is it? It is sealed. It's a done deal. So this is what he was doing, and Yosef was trying to open. Yosef was trying to, you know, this is what's supposed to happen, but that's not what the intent was. That is not what Yaakov felt through the Ruach, through the Holy Spirit, that he was supposed to do. Okay, so you're going to get blessed the right way by your dad. Okay, all right, thanks, boys. Yay! Isn't it interesting how you just happened to have brought them today? We planned it. So, you know, that's an illustration of, you know, he's closing. He says, no, this is the way it's supposed to be. It's a done deal. It is stuma. Okay, so Yaakov's right hand, the Menasha being on Yaakov's right, was supposed to receive the blessing of the firstborn. Ephraim on the left would get a lesser blessing, but he would still get a blessing. This blessing would include a major change in that Yaakov elevated Yosef's sons to the status of being his own sons. See, these were actually his grandsons. And that blessing is supposed to be given to your son, to your issue, to the fruit of your loins. That's what's supposed to be done. Fathers, bless your sons.
Amen.
You should always, and don't just say, hey, you're a good kid. You know, lay hands on them. Because if you don't start from the get-go laying hands on them in blessing, you're going to lay hands on them another way because they're going to earn something less than a blessing. So always bless your sons. It's important. Moms, you can bless your sons too. But it's so important for fathers. Oh my goodness. It's so important for fathers to bless their sons. Okay, so what he was doing is adopting these children as his own. Now, these children had been growing up in the land of Egypt under the guidance and tutelage of their father, Yosef. And I won't even try and pronounce his Egyptian name, Zephaphaneah or something like that. I don't know. Joseph. And, you know, he was a high official in Egypt. And so all these things were going around. And, you know, when, you know, they say it takes a village to raise, you know, a kid or kids. Well, if the village is not right, how are they raising their kids? So you have to have your hands-on guidance. And so
Yahweh was demonstrating that, yes, they're your sons, but they're mine too. And they are going to learn our ways, the ways of our fathers. And before I die, this is a done deal. Okay, so because of this, because he was blessing them as and adopting them as his own, Jewish parents bless their sons in this way. May you be like Ephraim and Manasseh. That blessing is very old, but is very beautiful and very powerful. This is in hope that they too would be elevated and admired for adhering to their faith, despite the temptations of Egypt or Babylon, where we're kind of residing in a form of Babylon right now. Yaakov blessed his sons and prophesied over them. Now this parsha is the last one in Bereshit, in Genesis. The parsha ends with the traditional shout of, and if you know it, shout with me, Chazak, Chazak, Vanik Chazek. It means be strong, and let us be strengthened. Some people interpret it as be courageous, and let us be encouraged. And both are, you know, they're both valid interpretations. Now, we go to Mlachim. Be careful with that word. Mlachim means kings. Malachim means angels or messengers. So it's Mlachim. So you say Lachim.
Lachim.
But you start with your lips in the M sound. Mlachim.
Mlachim.
Mlachim. Okay, there you go. So in Lahim Aleph, 1 Kings, King David certainly knows the consequences of not being strong. He is still a man after, in pursuit of, Yah's heart. So, David being at the end of his life, he calls his son Shlomo, Solomon, to charge him with continuing to keep Torah and the mitzvot, all the commandments of Adonai. David also charges Shlomo with teaching his sons in the ways of Yahweh. So you know the laying on of hands is happening. Anytime you bless somebody, it's with the laying on of hands. And I must kind of add an addendum there. Do not be quick to do that. I know there are people, you know, that will, you know, run at you and, you know, give you the smackdown. It's like, no, I don't want to be blessed by you. Be very careful of who you allow to lay hands on you. It's not to be done by everybody. When we bring people up to be prayed for or blessed, we're very careful who we ask to actually lay hands on them. Not everybody is allowed to do that. There's a certain way of doing that. First, you must have the okay. You must be sanctioned by the leadership to be able to do so. So this is a good sign to people who come in who are visiting, may not know, and they'll see everybody rushing to lay hands, and they'll do it too. If they see that, they'll figure, oh, I want to be part of the tribe, so I'll lay hands too. We don't know what they brought in. We don't know what kind of spiritual root they're harboring or bringing into this place. And so we don't want transference. We don't want to transfer any difficulties, any curses, anything on a person who's saying, please pray for me. I need help because I'm sick or I'm, you know, depressed or what have you. You don't want to add insult to injury. So be very careful about who you allow to lay hands and who you lay hands on. Be very certain that the Holy Spirit is guiding you to do so. If the Holy Spirit isn't telling you to do it, don't do it. Certainly you can pray for people. Everybody can be praying for people. But as far as touch, guard your touch. Okay? So that's my commercial. So, here
in Lahim, David, who is authorized, he's the king, and he's the father of his son. He puts his hand on his son's head and blesses him. And he is also telling Shlomo, I'm giving you the blessing, but there's a part to this blessing that has to go with it. You must also bless your sons and teach them in the ways of Yahweh. It's all part of the blessing. David prophesies that if Shlomo's children pay attention, I think it's interesting that they say pay attention, because so many people go through the motions. You know, they'll say a prayer that they've known for ages and ages, you know, maybe learned it as a small child, and it becomes meaningless. You know, you must pay attention. That means put it, you must have kavanah. Kavanah is intent and purpose, but it's a holy intent and purpose, not just, you know, your own agenda. But you must pay attention. You just can't, oh, okay, bless you. You know, you can't do that. You have, this is very serious business, so be very careful if you're paying attention. So he tells his children, Shlomo's children, to pay attention on how they live. You must do that too. And how they conduct themselves honestly and with all their heart and being. That he would never lack a man on the throne of Israel. This was very important. He was to do this so there was an assurance that the right person would be on that throne. He used the word faithfulness, which means walking out your faith, taking action, doing Torah, not just having faith. In the Hebrew language and culture, it's all about, you know, the idiom is action. It's very concrete. It's not like the Greek understanding of what's in scripture. The Greek understanding is very fluffy, it's very cerebral, and you know, in their way of thinking, faith is, oh yeah, I believe it, it's in my head. But in the Hebrew way of looking at things, faith is acting it out, is walking it out. Yes, I believe that Yeshua came, died to save me, to save all of us who receive him, and that he's coming back. He rose again, he's coming back again. I believe that in my mind, but I not only believe it in my mind, I conduct myself in a way that shows that I believe it. So there's a difference. Many people have head knowledge of who Yeshua or Jesus is. Oh yeah, he's the, you know, when I was a baby believer, oh yeah, he's the baby in the manger. Yeah, oh, who doesn't love a baby? And that's all, you know, that's all I thought he was. I didn't know. I didn't have, you know, that solid belief, that faithfulness in walking out my faith, knowing that he didn't stay a baby. And yes, he went to the cross, but he didn't stay there. And yes, he's in heaven, right, at the right side of the Father, but he's not going to stay there. He's coming back. And I want to conduct myself in a way that shows that that's what I believe. So many people, yeah, oh, I believe in Jesus, yeah, I know who he is. But they don't act like they're serving him. They don't act like they made him their Lord. And that's the difference. Faithfulness, not just faith, faithfulness. In the Brit Hadashah, in the Renewed Covenant, in Yochanan, in John, Yeshua also knew that his days on here, on the earth here, were drawing to a close. See the pattern? Each one of the three people in the readings knew that their days, end of days was coming. Yet his concern, Yeshua's concern, was toward his Talmidim, toward his disciples. Had he equipped them properly? You know, that would be a question. If, you know, if I had students, I would want to know, gee, did I teach them properly? Or did I just spout off and, you know, not pay attention. He was probably asking himself, were they ready to face the world without him? Yes, he was still with them, you know, in spirit. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. forsake you. I will be with you even to the end of the age. Or end of the world, however your translation reads. He would be with them, but physically he was going to the Father. He was not going to be physically with them. So how would they act without him? Would they walk out their faith? Or would they simply say, oh yeah, I knew him when, and go back to hanging out with fish or whatever they were doing in their previous occupation? So he was probably thinking about these things. I'm ready to go. Are they equipped? Are they ready for my departure? He knew that he could not give them a false sense of self. They must know, as we must know, that we are all but dust. Just because they walked with him, talked with him, ate with them, it didn't elevate them this life. They still had to know that they were, and as we are, unworthy. How amazing that the King of absolutely everything should first come down from his lofty throne, and he himself made mikvah. He asked to be baptized, like the sinners that were around. He asked. This is humbling. But he had to do it in order to fulfill all righteousness. And then he humbles himself even further, giving perfect example of serving in humility by washing his disciples' feet. A leader cannot ask their followers to go somewhere where they themselves would not go. A leader must lead. A leader must go forth and enter the land, just like Moshe. He didn't enter the land, but Joshua, he entered the land. He was the leader then. He couldn't say, well, there it is, go ahead. Like what is that movie, How the West Was Won, or whatever, where they're racing to get their chunk of land. Go! No, he had to lead them. He had to lead them. Abraham had to lead them too. He himself had to go. So a leader has to be willing to do what he asks, or she asks, the followers to do. And be willing to go where they ask their followers to go. Well then, if that weren't enough, the washing of the feet, if you've ever washed anybody's feet, you get all kinds of feet. Sometimes it's a pleasant experience and sometimes it's not quite, but you do it. So then, if it weren't enough, Yeshua allows himself to be humiliated before his Talmidim, before his disciples, his brothers and sisters, his mother, and the Roman occupiers, and yes, Yahweh himself, his father, in order to fulfill all that was prophesied about him by being stripped naked, by being tortured, whipped, and eventually nailed to the execution stake and put on display for all to see. How humiliating. I don't know which is worse, the pain or the humiliation, and he endured both. In all three readings, we see ordinary human beings, seemingly, exchange their ordinary lives for an extraordinary future. You could say that Yaakov and David were trailblazers, in effect going where no man has gone before. That's for your own Star Trek fan. Their journey does not end with their deaths. Because of their faith in a promise-keeping God, they embark on their next journey into the unknown, trusting that Yahweh will receive them and guard, guide, and strengthen the generations that come after them. Knowing that their time on earth is at an end, they impart the blessing on their children so that a small part of them would continue to live through the next generation. The same example is seen in the Brit Chadashah as Yeshua calls us for his followers away from the lives that they've always known to a new life and a new destiny as kingdom builders. Yeshua instructs them and the others that will soon come to learn from him, to see themselves as changed from what they were. They must pursue holiness, being set apart, as modeled by the very Son of Yahweh himself. They would become spiritual sons of Messiah. Incidentally, even though Yeshua knew that he would die, he did not impart the blessing on them before his crucifixion, because he knew that he wasn't going to be gone for long. It wasn't until that they were prepared to step into their new lives as emissaries for the kingdom that Yeshua imparted the blessing as a father blesses his children right before ascending back to the Father. Can you imagine? Can you picture as he's rising up, ascending to the Father? He's got a great way of imparting the blessing on all of them that are still standing on the earth below. We too are learning to leave our old lives and step into our destiny. We are a set-apart people, bombarded each and every day by wickedness and paganism in its many, many forms, idolatry, immorality, and the temptation to assimilate and conform to what this society considers normal. We are a peculiar people. Some are a little more peculiar than others. But we're to be a peculiar people, and I don't mean that as an insult. We're to be seen as peculiar to everyone around us. I know very well, I've got an old friend that knew me back when, before I was a believer. And now he just looks at me and scratches his head and says, "What happened to you?" And I say, "Oh no, it's not what, it's who." Yahweh calls us to be holy because he is holy. The good news is if we put our trust in Yeshua and allow him to rule and reign in our lives, he will preserve us through all of these days and all of these challenges. He will deliver us from the evil way in this evil day. It is that trust, that faithfulness, that gives us the strength to persevere. So be joyful. Be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Be like Ephraim and Manasseh. Chazak, chazak, bani chazek. Be strong. Be strong and be strengthened. All rise for the Hanukkah.
This is the Torah that Moshe placed before the children of Israel. It is in accord with the Lord's command by the hand of Moses.
This old Torah, Asher Sam Moshe, Lifnei
pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Long life is in its right hand, and in its left are riches and honor. The Lord was pleased for the sake of his righteousness to render the Torah great and glorious.
Thank you.
that this time in our service we choose to bless our children. And you may have noticed today that the way we bless our children comes right out of Scripture. And this is important. This leadership of this congregation feels it is important to use the lessons of the Bible as we are in obedience and how we conduct ourselves in this congregation. And it was clear today an example of how we should bless our children. So this is what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And if you would maybe have the children that are here today stand with your father so that your father may bless you. For the rest of us, you keep in mind the children that are in your own families and also the orphans that we support in Uganda. So let's raise a hand. First of all, for the sons, may you be like Ephraim and Manasseh, forgetting the troubles of your past and having a fruitful future. And like Kepha, Yaakov, and Yochanan, who followed Messiah Yeshua. And for the daughters, may you be like Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, and Leah, who built the house of Israel. And like Miriam, the mother of Yeshua, who said yes to Adonai. B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Man, I love it when we have the next generation, Joshua generation. Yeah. Okay, we just have a couple of announcements. Our next Bible study will be on Wednesday, January 2nd at 7 p.m. And this will be hosted by Sherry Rizek at 6645 Finishing Drive in Rockford. We will meet in the community room. Please let me know if you are attending, and it would be nice if somebody would volunteer to bring some treats, some cookies or crackers or fruit or whatever. Nothing extensive, just a little something to share. Our next day to serve at the Rockford Rescue Mission is Sunday, January 20th at 9 p.m. Please meet at the back entrance. Oh, yeah. I won't forget about this. Tomorrow, we have an event over at The Vine, and it's called Last Minute Market. And I know a lot of people are out there doing their last minute shopping and going crazy. And so this is an opportunity to not only help people get some of the things they might need, gift giving. Also, this will help to support the Cafe at the Vine and also the Vine itself. And also, a percentage of the profits are going to the Uganda Children's, the Orphans Ministry. And so we're asking people, please come, tell your friends and neighbors, you know, if they're looking for some good deals, they're going to be there. We've got 11 vendors right now. And Eric's probably wondering, how do you have them all in there? I have a plan, I need a map. Yeah. So they're going to be there, and there's everything from there's a gal bringing paparazzi jewelry, there's somebody who does painted screens and shutters. I talked to Carrie. She's going to be selling her wooden signs. They're wonderful wooden signs. They're not just on the wall for decoration, folks. Yeah, they're for sale, and they use the money for to fund the ministry. And other things. We're going to have hot chocolate and coffee and some hot cider and some sweets as well. And so it's going to be a fun time. It's going to be tomorrow between the hours of 1 and 5. And if you would, if you're on Facebook, please, you'll see the ad on Facebook.
please share that. I'm actually running a contest. The person who shares it with the most people on Facebook, I've got a special gift for them. And so when you come, you claim your gift. I'll know the winner by tomorrow. And I know who's really far ahead in the running. I won't mention any names, but it's really easy. If you're on Facebook, just share the ad with the people that you know, especially if they're in the area. Let them know. And so anyway, please come and support this event. And then remember to pray for our dear Ugandan orphans and Brother Daniel. They are in need of funds to supply the orphans with food, medicine, basic necessities. They're finishing the upper level to the orphanage, to the dorms. So they need building materials and other supplies to do that. So please prayerfully consider being a regular donor to the Nova Shalom's Orphan Care Project or sponsoring a child through the United Orphan Child Care Ministries. And that can be done online as well. And we also want to remind everybody, if this is your home congregation, wonderful. Wherever your home congregation is, whether it's here or elsewhere, you know, please support your home congregation with your tithes and offerings. If this is not your home congregation, but the Lord put in your heart to give, we would be so thankful. We are in search of a new place, and so that takes funds, that takes money. So I'll stop begging and just let you remind you that the basket is in the back if you want to move to put anything into it. Okay?
I just wanted to put my own little plug in for tomorrow's event. A lot of us have a desire to get a gift for somebody at this time of year. And you have the choice of going to Walmart or the mall, and that cattle drive, or you can come to a more intimate setting to look at original art. So that you'd be giving, and you're going to be able to talk to the actual vendors, the people who produce the products. So it's kind of a nice, interesting way to spend the afternoon, and you won't have to watch the bears. So.
One more thing, Eric. I'm sorry to interrupt. Your paintings are for sale, right? Or you want to mark the ones that are?
No. Others are.
The others are. Okay. All right. I just want to make sure because I don't want to like empty the walls. What are you giving me?
So that's a nice clarification because some of the art on the walls over there are just for the enjoyment. The artist put them up there for us to enjoy. We look at them and appreciate art, original art. So it's a nice place. I really appreciate Eric opening up the doors and allowing us to be there. We try to be good tenants there and provide interesting activities for people to do. That's all I have. Is that okay? Mika, can I invite you to do the Aaronic benediction and close the service?
Yiverachachadunah
May Yahweh turn his countenance to you. May Yahweh give you his shalom, Sar Shalom, Yeshua HaMashiach. And may he be with you in this new week. Shem Yeshua. Hallelujah.